worship the giver of life. Worship the God that can do all things. Worship the one that is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, the God that never fails, the God that is so dependable. Lift up your voice to Him wherever you are. Give Him worship. Give Him worship. Give Him worship. Jesus, we give you all the worship. Blessed be your name, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have worshiped. Father in heaven, we bow before you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for the great and mighty things you continue to do in our midst. Thank you for what you are set to do in the meeting of this morning. Please, Lord, accept our thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. As we hear your word this morning, please speak to our hearts. Let your word heal us. Let your word do us good. Let your word transform us. Let your word revive us again. Save souls like never before. Restore hope to the hopeless. Turn the tides around in our favor. And at the end, take all the glory. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. You are sure this morning that the Lord will arise on your behalf. Shout aloud, amen.
Amen.
And you are so certain that you are not living here the same way you came. Shout another loud, amen.
Amen.
And then there's just one person who understands and believes that he will live here with the biggest blessing. Let that one shout the loudest, amen. God bless you. Please recover your seats. Choristers, God bless you. You can take your seat. A very good morning to everyone. Because you are here this morning, the Lord will pay you a special visit. And you will surely not live here the same way you came, in the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. And I'll read from verse 31 to 39. Romans chapter 8, from verse 31 to 39. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died. Yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
I will read from verse 35 to 38 in NLT. Because I'm trying to bring up something here. 35 to 38, let me have it in NLT. It says, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us.
Amen.
And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love.
Amen.
Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above and in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
This morning, I'll be speaking briefly as time will permit us on the topic, if God be for us. I want someone to fill it up. If God be for us. Listen to me this morning. It doesn't matter what is happening around you. It doesn't matter the situation you're finding yourself now. One assurance I can give to at least 10 persons is that God is on your side. In Psalm 118, verse 6 and 7. Psalm 118, verse 6 and 7. It says, the Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do unto me? The Lord taketh my part with them that help me. Therefore shall I see my desire upon them that hate me. May I pray for someone here today. In the name that is above every other name. Since God is on your side, every gang up of the forces of darkness to bring you down, they will fail in the name of Jesus. And may I pray for someone else again in the order of Psalm 118, verse 6 and 7. Every plot of the enemy against your life and destiny, they scatter as I say it now in the name of Jesus. And every man who has made himself so strong a contender in your life, in the name that is above every other name, because God is on your side, he will humiliate them completely in the name of Jesus. They will come against you in one way, but in seven ways, my God will scatter them. They will arise to contend with you, but in the name of the God that is on your side, they will fall for your sake. Amen. The louder your amen, receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So if you live here without anything, live with something. That God is on my side. Say it as if you mean it. God is on my side. Say it one more time. God is on my side. Announce it to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but for me and my family, God is on our side. You receive that shout aloud, amen. And so shall it be. God is on your side. But there are two things I need you to know this morning. Two very fundamental facts that you need to know. Even if you know, you need to take to heart. And number one, life can be very challenging. Very, very challenging. Anyone that is living in this country today will understand what I mean. But Jesus said something. In John chapter 16 and verse 33, John 16, 33, you'll give it to me in King James Version, in NIV, and in NLT. It says, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. NIV says, in this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. NLT says, here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. The one who is saying take heart is the one that has the power to fix everything. So life can really be very challenging. But there's no challenge you are facing now that is new. There's nothing happening to you today, happening to any one of us, that you can look around and say it is new. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 9 to 10, NLT. Ecclesiastes 1, 9 to 10, NLT. Ecclesiastes 9. It says, history merely repeats itself. It has all been done before. Nothing under the sun is truly new. Verse 10. Sometimes people say, here is something new. But actually, it is old. Nothing is ever truly new. Nothing. Tough times had always existed. From the beginning of creation. If you read Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, darkness existed from the very beginning. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. Poverty and lack had been from of old. In fact, it is part of life. How do I know? Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 10 and 11, NLT. Deuteronomy 15, 10 and 11. He says, give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. Look at verse 11. He says, there will always be some in the land who are what? Always. Always. That is why I am commanding you to share freely with the poor and with other Israelites in need. Because from the very beginning, poverty, some will be poor. But I pray you not be one of those. Because your name is not there. It only says some will be poor. Nothing is new under the sun. Today we talk about barrenness. Sarah was barren for 90 years. Until God opened her womb. Rebecca, read your Bible very well. For 20 solid years, her womb was shut until God intervened. Rachel, you know her story. Hannah, you know her story. Elizabeth. Nothing is new under the sun. Today we talk about wicked people. Wickedness had existed from the very beginning. Envy, assassinations, and killings have been taking place from of old in scriptures. In the book of Genesis chapter 4, from verse 1 to 12. Genesis 4, 1 to 12. This is the story of how Adam and Eve met. And then they gave birth to two children. Cain and Abel. Both of them were, doing their business. And it got to a time they were to bring offering before God. Cain brought his, but the Lord rejected his offering. But accepted the offering of his brother. Because of that, Cain got very angry. And then decided to take on his brother. And while they were in the field, the Bible said, Cain rose up against his brother. And killed him. Your only brother. He killed him. What did he do? Nothing. Just that God accepted his offering and rejected that of Cain. And so the only answer, the only response for that kind of situation was for him to take out the life of his brother. And God pronounced a curse on him. If you read verse 11 and 12 of Genesis chapter 4, it says, and now art thou cursed from the earth. Let me read it in NLT. Now you are cursed and banished from the ground, which has swallowed your brother's blood. No longer will the ground yield good crops for you, no matter how hard you work. From now on, you will be a homeless wanderer. On the earth. Wickedness had existed from of old. I remember some years back, a young man graduated from the university. As he was finishing from the university, he got a job in one of these blue chip companies. And he was so excited. He shared the news with his friends and took them out. They went out to have a drink to just celebrate. While they were there, one of the friends poisoned him. And he died. He never got to resume in that place. I pray for someone here today. Every act of wickedness targeted against anyone hearing the sound of my voice, in the name that is above every other name, they backfire today in the name of Jesus. Nothing is new. I'm saying this so that you understand that whatever you are passing through is not new to you. It's not new. We have seen people who have been so rich in time past. Suddenly, they become like paupers. And they start begging. And it's in the Bible. Ecclesiastes 10 verse 7. Ecclesiastes 10 verse 7 says, I've seen servants upon horses and princes walking as servants upon the earth. If you read 2 Samuel chapter 9, it tells you the account of a young man called Mephibosheth. All of you know the story. Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan. The grandfather was a king. Everything was working well for the young man until just one day, Saul went to the battlefield. That day he died. Jonathan died. News came to the palace that the king and the heir apparent had died. And so the maid was taking this young man, you know, put him on the back and was running to escape from the palace because they didn't know what was going to happen next. The boy fell, became crippled. From that moment, he went to a place they call Lodebar. And that was where he was, you know, just wasting away. A prince that was living and enjoying, you know, the good things of life. Suddenly, the sun set. May I pray again for someone? Your sun will never set at noonday. Your good will not suddenly become bad in the name of Jesus. Your joy will never be mixed with sorrow in the name of Jesus. The louder your amen, receive it in the name of Jesus. And then, of course, you know the story of Joseph, a young man that the father loved so much and made a coat of many colors for him. The father was grooming him to take over the business. And so he kept sending him to check out his brothers and to know what was happening in the field until suddenly everything turned. On this particular day, the brother sold him. A young man enjoying so much wealth and affluence became a slave in another country. From Potiphar's house, he ended up in prison. Everything changed. But I pray for you again. Your joy will never be turned to sorrow. So life can be very, very challenging. But thank God there is one who has the solution to every problem. So no matter what you are passing through, I'd like you to understand that God is in control. The second point you must note this morning. No matter how challenging life can be, tough times don't last. Because God will always make a way. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13. Let me read it in NLT so that I can bring it out well. It says, the temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptation to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, he will show you a way out so that you can endure. One thing I've learned in life, this scripture has kept me going. In every challenge you find yourself, if God is on your side, there will always be a way out. Once you have that understanding, you don't slip into depression. Because when you hear people say they want to take their lives, it is because they have lost hope completely that concerning this challenge and this problem, there is no solution anymore. So the only way out is to end it. But I have good news for you today. God will make a way for you. Yeah. Darkness showed up in Genesis. God introduced light. He said, let there be light. And there was light. Darkness vanished. The first Adam messed up. God introduced the second Adam. In 1 Corinthians 15, 47 to 48, NLT. 1 Corinthians 15, 47 to 48. He said, the first man is of the earth. The second man is the Lord from heaven. Give it to me in NLT. Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven. And he that is above is above all. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, to read from verse 1, David returned from battle, and he got to Ziklag, his camp, and discovered that everything he had been taken away by the Amalekites. The Bible said he was depressed. He wept and wept and wept until they had no strength in them to weep, himself and the men. Now it got so bad, because when things like this happen, people now look for who to blame. And the men started saying, if you had not taken us out, this wouldn't have happened. So they were already planning and thinking of how to stone him to death. But David remembered. And the Bible said, he encouraged himself in the Lord. He put himself together. He remembered that God is on his side. And then he now went and asked of the Lord, this is a challenge. What shall we do? Shall we pursue? Shall we overtake? Can we recover? And God said, pursue, overtake, and recover. May I pray for someone here? It doesn't matter what you may have lost. It doesn't matter how bad the situation may look like. Because God is on your side, he will make a way for you. Amen. I said God will make a way for you. Amen. The louder your amen, receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. How will he do it? He will send help to you. Amen. May I announce to at least 20 persons here, help is on the way. If you understand what I'm saying, you will say a better amen. Help is on the way. Isaiah chapter 41 verse 10 to 13. Isaiah 41 verse 10 to 13. It says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. He said, behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing, and they that strive with thee shall perish. Your amen is weak. It says, thou shalt seek them and shall not find them, even them that contendeth with thee. They that war against thee shall be as nothing, and as a thing of naught. For I am the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not. I will do what? I will help thee. Stand on your feet. Lift up your voices, man, and say, Father, send help to me. Go ahead and pray that prayer. Make a way for me. Turn my challenges to testimonies. Lift up your voice and pray that prayer. Father, send help to me. Make a way for me. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. I'd like you to pray that prayer for someone close to you. You lift up your voice and say, Father, in every area of the life of my neighbor, by your grace and mercy, send help to him. Make a way for him. Go ahead and pray. Send help to my neighbor. Make a way for him. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. In Psalm 60, verse 11, it says, give us help from trouble, for vain is the help of man. In NLT, it says, oh, please help us against our enemies, for all human help is useless. If God does not help you, there's a limit to how far you can go. If you're depending on the help of man, you'll be thoroughly disappointed. Because man is limited. I want to pray for you this morning. But I'd like you to stretch forth your hands towards the altar. God is on your side. That area of your life where you need his help, I'd like you to talk to him now. Be very specific. No matter how big, talk to him about it. And while we are praying, if you are in this meeting you know that you can't truly say that you are on the Lord's side. You are not very sure that God will arise on your behalf because you need to settle with Him in certain areas of your life. If you are here, please quickly come before the altar. I want to pray with you so that the help of God will truly, truly locate you today. You know you have things you need to settle with your Maker. You know there are ways that you need to reconcile with Him. Or you want to don't be ashamed though. You need the help of God. The Lord is waiting for you. Come and reconnect with Gallery from the extension, from the overflow downstairs, the main auditorium. Come. Come and settle with your Maker. God bless you. God bless you.
Hold of my hip, hold it from the
moon. Give us that song just once. Blessed be your name, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. There's someone here in this meeting, in this service. You've been going after a particular thing that is so important to your life and to your destiny. But every time you knock on that door, they keep telling you it's not yet your turn. The word of God is coming to you this morning, and the Lord is saying, I should tell you, I'm the one that opens a door and no man can shut. He says, this time, I've opened that door for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Stretch forth your hands towards the altar. And someone here this morning, everyone around you, everything around you points to the fact that things will not work in your favor. But the Lord says, I am the beginning and the ending. I am rearranging everything to begin to work in your favor. Father, we thank you for this visitation. That despite our weaknesses, you have made up your mind to be on our side. Please accept our thanks in the name of Jesus Christ. All of these, your children whose hands are stretched out to you in this service, including those connected online to this meeting, whatever it is they are trusting you for your help and for you to make a way for them, I join my faith with all of these, your children, and I pray that, Lord, before the end of this month, you will send help to them. For those whose faith can carry it within the next 24 hours, Father, please send help to them. And for those whose faith can go the extra mile before this day is over, let them receive uncommon help. Do it in your own way and take all the glory. Thank you, everlasting Father. I pray that from now on, because you are on the side of your children and because you are on our side, anyone that will rise up against us to contend with our lives and destinies, if they fail to repent, my Father and my God, may you bring them down in your anger. Put an end to the wickedness of the wicked. And let the joy of your children overflow. So shall it be. In Jesus' name we have prayed. All of these, your children standing before your altar, the grace they need to reconnect with you, release to them all. Help them to serve you better. Give them the strength to follow you to the very end. Thank you, everlasting Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. You receive it, shout amen 3 times. Announce to your neighbor, two or three of them, and say to them, neighbor, I don't know about you, but for me, God is on my side and help is on the way for me. You receive that, shout aloud amen. Put your hands together for the Lord as you take your seats.